The NBA G League has been really exciting the last few years. It's hosted former NBA stars, former viral sensations, first round rookies, and now even top draft prospects. So today, we're going to talk about guys you didn't know were in the G League and how they are doing. So if you guys like the content, smash the like button, smash the subscribe button. Let's aim for 24 likes on today's video, and let's get into this. Now this should be fun, because I know some of you guys know at least a few of these players are in the G League, but I don't think you know them all. I was surprised by a lot of these. We're going to start with a fan favorite that I'm really excited to see killing it in the G League so far, and that's Mac McClung. While it might not seem that impressive that he's been able to get to this point in his career with how crazy the hype for him was in high school when he was throwing down crazy dunks and beating all Allen Iverson's Virginia high school records, it actually is. While it was probably disrespectful, he was nowhere to be seen on the national recruiting rankings. It's very rare for those guys to end up making it to the league, but it's looking like he's got a fighting chance. After two pretty rough seasons at Georgetown and then a solid year at Texas Tech, he would go undrafted in the recent draft, but he landed a summer league opportunity with the Lakers. Now, I can't say it was all that impressive. In his five games, he averaged around 16 minutes, where he put up 4 points a game, shooting an atrocious 19% from the field and 9% from three. He then signed a training camp deal with the Lakers, and he appeared in their three preseason games for an average of 5 minutes, where he put up just over a point a game. He would then get waived, but signed a deal with their G League affiliate, and in his first game, he looked really impressive. He dropped 24 points, 9 assists, and 6 rebounds, shooting 9 for 18 from the field and 3 for 9 from 3. I really hope he can keep this up and earn himself an NBA opportunity, because man, do I want to see him on an NBA breakaway. Next up, we've got a former top player in the league trying to get a chance again, Lance Stephenson. Now, it's not common that we see players in their 30s go to the G League after such a successful NBA career, but after being on the Lakers in 2019, then going and playing in China last season, he's clearly not ready to give up. He's playing for the Nuggets G League affiliate after being selected with the 13th pick in the G League draft, and he's clearly at the top of this level of competition. He dropped 26 points and 9 rebounds in his debut, shooting 8 for 19 from the field and 2 for 5 from 3. As much as I loved Lance Stephenson's presence in the league, based on his last few seasons we saw him, I think it's safe to say his days of being a difference maker on an NBA roster are long gone. He isn't the only familiar face. The G League is also hosting a former 8th overall pick in the draft, Brandon Knight. Knight was a top-ranked player in high school, then obviously a top prospect in the draft, and would get off to a very solid start in his NBA career. He averaged 13 points and 4 assists as a rookie in Detroit, and by his third season, now in Milwaukee, he was averaging 18 points and 5 assists a game. That wouldn't even be the best season of his career. A couple years later, as a member of the Suns, he was averaging nearly 20 points a game, but sadly, injuries would really hurt him going forward. He would never even average double digits for a season again. He would bounce around the league, and the last time we saw him was for a small stint with the Pistons in 2019. He was selected with the 6th overall pick in the G League draft by the Heat's G League affiliate. He's been playing pretty well, and he actually has a bigger sample size than most of the players we're going to talk about. He's already played in 4 games, averaging 19-6-5, shooting over 40% from 3. It's a tough road ahead, but if his success continues here, I wouldn't be too surprised to see him get another NBA opportunity. There's also quite a few notable drafted rookies playing in the G League, some of which I'm really surprised to see, such as James Bouknight. I really thought he was going to have an opportunity available pretty early on in Charlotte after being the 11th overall pick, but it doesn't look like that's going to be the case. He was one of my favorite prospects in the draft, and so far in the G League, it looks like he has a bright future ahead. In his debut, he came out there and dropped 33 points, 7 rebounds and 3 assists, shooting 9 for 22 from the field and 5 for 12 from 3. I really like what the G League has become. It's giving young players like Bouknight the opportunity to get much needed game action, even though it's expected for them to be productive players for the team that drafted them in the near future. I really wouldn't be surprised to see Bouknight's career escalate very quickly from here. Their other first round selection in the recent draft, Kai Jones, also had an impressive debut. He put up 15 points and 7 rebounds, but most of the conversation about him was due to his highlight step back three. Another lottery pick playing in the G League is Joshua Primo, who was selected with the very next selection after Bouknight. Now, seeing him in the G League, despite the Spurs really having no playoff hopes, isn't that surprising. He came into the draft as by far the youngest player selected. It's been months since the draft, but Primo is still just 18 years old and won't be 19 till Christmas Eve. So far, he's played just a handful of minutes on the main roster, but since being assigned to the G League, has been super impressive. In his two games so far, he averaged 21 points and 5 assists, shooting 48% from the field and 50% from 3. Some other notable rookies include the Hawks selections of Sharif Cooper and Jalen Johnson. They were both super impressive in the summer league, but as we know, there's a lot of mouths to feed in Atlanta, so it makes sense to develop these guys here. I really like the position they're in with these two. The Hawks have a lot of decisions to make, more specifically, a lot of people to pay, with the contracts of both Cam Reddish and DeAndre Hunter coming to an end after next season. Having these two guys really gives them flexibility going forward. In Jalen Johnson's first two G League games, he's averaged 14 points and 11 rebounds, shooting 38% from three, while Cooper's averaged 19-5, but hasn't had great efficiency to this point. Despite the Hawks' struggle as a team to start this season, you've got to feel good about their future, just given that their depth is carrying over into the G League. I would say the last notable rookie we've seen is Keon Johnson, who for most of the draft process looked like a likely top 10 selection, but towards the tail end would fall and eventually land with the Clippers at the 21st pick. In his two G League games, he's averaged 18 points, 5 rebounds, and 4 assists. Now let's get into some guys that weren't first round talents, but are still some of the most notable names in the sport, and we'll begin with Taco Fall. He really bursted onto the scene in high school, mainly due to his insane height, standing at 7'6". He would then go on to play at UCF, where all things considered, it was pretty solid, but would go undrafted in 2019, but the hype only grew from there. From playing in the summer league to the bench of the Boston Celtics, late in blowouts, arenas erupted with chants of Taco, trying to get him in the game, some of which were quite successful. But while he was a fun player to root for, it was pretty clear that his NBA career would never really amount to too much. Like many players of his size, his per 36 numbers were absolutely ridiculous, but these kind of players can never ramp up their minutes too much, and in today's game, we just demand too much from the center position. His role was really reduced to just defending last-second opponent inbound attempts, and going into this season, he signed with the Cleveland Cavaliers, but his contract was quickly converted to a two-way deal. In his first game in the G League, he put up 23 points, 12 rebounds, and 2 blocks, shooting 10 for 13 from the field. The NBA is not 2K. It's hard to imagine him really ever doing anything significant in the league, but man, I think we all wish that would happen. Probably the biggest name in the G League. Bigger than guys like Lance Stephenson, or even his G League teammate that was a lottery selection, James Bouknight, it's LiAngelo Ball, the middle child of the famous, or to some infamous, Ball family. He's had a crazy basketball journey. He went from being the leading scorer of a national championship Chino Hills team alongside his brothers. He would then go to UCLA, eventually get arrested in China, then go to Lithuania, then to the JBA. He rehabbed some injuries, then went to the Pistons for training camp, then the OKC Blue G League team, then to the Hornets Summer League team, and now to their G League affiliate. All while his brothers became top 3 picks in the draft, Lonzo's fresh off signing an $80 million deal, and LaMelo just won Rookie of the Year and is already climbing the rankings of the league's elite point guards. I think everyone wants to see him in the NBA. Whether you're a hater that just wants to prove you are right, or you want to see these three brothers all being in the league at the same time, making LaVar statements that at one point seem ridiculous reality. Now, going into the summer league, my expectations for LiAngelo were honestly pretty low, but overall, I was impressed. From his confidence to his hustle, he really didn't look out of place, as some expected. He averaged 10 points in just 17 minutes of action, shooting 35% from three. He would end up being selected with the 14th overall pick in the G League draft to the Hornets G League affiliate, the Greensboro Swarm. He's played 4 games so far, averaging just 14 minutes, where he's been extremely productive in that time, averaging 9 points, shooting over 50% from the field and from 3. He's in an interesting position going forward. Comparing him to the rest of the guys in the G League fighting for roster spots isn't fair. He isn't in that same position. He's better compared to a guy like Thanasis Antetokounmpo. I think it's safe to say he's probably not in the league right now if it wasn't for the Bucks' efforts to please Giannis. In today's league, where young players are requesting trades left and right, it truly wouldn't be that surprising for a small market like Charlotte to give LiAngelo a chance in order to make sure that LaMelo wants to be here for a very long time. And honestly, if the expectations were appropriate, I think he could hold his own. It's hard to say where his defense is right now, but we know we can shoot the ball. The league really has some interesting storylines brewing. How crazy would it be in a few years from now, the Ball brothers all team back up on a roster, let's say the Hornets, while LeBron James and Bronny James are also sharing the court on another team. That game might break some viewership records. Then we've got another player that's also probably only given this opportunity due to who he's related to, and that's Zaire Wade, son of NBA legend Dwayne Wade. Zaire went to a top high school program in Sierra Canyon, then did a year of prep school at Brewster, but was never given much recruiting attention. He had a few D1 offers from schools like DePaul and Nebraska, but no top programs, and decided to go the professional route. There was a lot of rumblings. He was going to go to a league like the Australian NBL, but he ended up landing in the G League. Now, what's interesting about this situation is that Dwayne Wade recently acquired a minority stake in the Utah Jazz, and well, their G League affiliate, the Salt Lake City Stars, are who selected Zaire with the 10th overall pick in the G League draft. I think we know what happened there. He's played two games so far, averaging around 25 minutes, but scoring just 5 points, shooting 36% from the field. In all honesty, I don't think we're going to be seeing him on the NBA court anytime soon, but I really hope we do. Maybe we could see Dwayne come out of retirement and have a squadron of Dwayne Wade, Zaire Wade, LeBron James, and his son Bronny. That would be insane. Lastly, I just want to mention some top prospects that are playing for the G League Ignite. There's really two guys on the map right now as possible first round selections. You've got Jaden Hardy, who was a top prospect in high school and came into the season likely to be a top selection in the draft. I'm really excited to see what he does this season, and while he's still projected to be a top pick, it's been a pretty rough start. In his 4 games, he's averaged 15 points, 6 rebounds, and 3 assists, shooting just 28% from the field, but I have a feeling the talent is too much here, and this is quickly going to go up. And then you've got Dyson Daniels, who's gotten off to a pretty solid start, averaging 12 points, 6 rebounds, and 4 assists, shooting 46% from the field and 36% from 3. But that's the end for you guys. You guys tell me your thoughts in the comments below. If you liked the video, smash the like button, smash the subscribe button, and I'll catch you guys next time. Peace.